we've all watched it on television, watching the youth, the young people return to what they consider their place of safety before. But we've seen the community and the world come together to support them and to demonstrate love. There was a march in Weston yesterday and a vigil where people gathered together. 2 weeks ago, we had a vigil here outside a candlelight vigil. 275 people from the community gathered together on these sacred grounds to pray for them, to pray for hope. Part of that experience was we had a table where we had these blank canvases for people who gathered to write messages to the students. And they were spread out and marching happy, guided people through the process. Messages like, be brave, you are all loved. May God's light always be with you. Abiding in our hearts always, gratitude always, and the courage to change the world. And that's what they're doing. These posters, these many posters, with all of this love and all of these messages will be delivered to the school this week for them to hang in the hallway. To know that we may be 30 minutes away, but they're part of this community. We love them. We won't forget. We'll work with them. We'll be inspired by them. We'll march with them on March 24th. And we'll always be here for them. So let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for the youth. Jesus reminded us that you must be like children to experience, to enter the kingdom of heaven. The youth are now presenting an example for us, the adults. May we listen. May we be called to action. May we continue to support them. We thank you for watching over them as they return to school and then the following days. From therapy dogs to people from out all around the world coming together to love them. We thank you for that blessing. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.
Christ Jesus. So that in the ages to come, he might show the immeasurable richness of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus.
through 21. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come into the light so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. Thank you, David. That was wonderful. thanks for being here for church since we had daylight savings time last night. There'll be more people come at 11:30 than might be here now. Any excuse. But choir, it's time. And Sergeant did a great job last week. They liked my joke about winning the role. But you have a question this morning. Now, we just went through daylight savings time where you had to turn your clock ahead an hour, right? We don't like that. Lose an hour. But my favorite time is when we roll back an hour. But I don't do that at 2 a.m. like they say. I roll my clock back at 1 p.m. That way, I get to eat lunch twice. It's noon twice, get it? Yes. I love that. Indians. But on this Lenten journey, these 40 days, where our focus has been on the journey of Jesus and justice, our luggage is starting to show some wear and tear, isn't it? It's been a journey of places to which we're familiar, but it's also been a journey of foreign lands, which is good. We've traveled through the who, what, when in the last 3 weeks, and today we travel through the why. Who, we learned from John 3:16, as we read again today, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. There's no asterisk next to whosoever. And for what? From 1 Corinthians 13:13, we learn, and now faith, hope, and love abide. These three, and the greatest of these is what? Love. When? Oh, Sarge, I watched the video when you turned that table over last week. You scared me too. You woke us up to the time of when is now. That's what the gospel teaches us. Jesus, when he ministered to people, he didn't say, we have a meal program on Thursday, come back next week. Did he? And what I see through this church, sometimes people show up during the week and we go, we have a program on Thursday, but we'll put a little something together. We'll provide you a pair of shoes. You don't have to wait till next Thursday. The time is now. When? We talked about the tables Jesus turned over in the temple, the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves. And Jesus says, my house shall be called the house of prayer, yet you made it a den of thieves. Is that what the church has done today? The time is now. But when I thought about the temples last week, we're taught in Bible school and Sunday school that our bodies are temples. God created us out of dust. We are in the image of God. So on February 14th, when 17 people were hurt and killed, God was God was hurt. God was severely wounded. But we know that God is everlasting. That's what the scriptures reveal to us. That's what experience shows and proves to us. That God is everlasting. What happened to the 17 people at the high school defiled God's temple. And now, why me, Lord? Why today? Have you ever seen a discussion between a child and a parent or an adult? And the child keeps asking, Why? But why? Why? You might have done that to your own parent. It was fun, wasn't it? I've heard, honey, you shouldn't eat the toothpaste. That's for brushing your teeth. Why? Well, if you eat it, you'll get sick. Why? Toothpaste is for brushing your teeth. Why? So you won't get cavities. But why? So that your teeth won't fall out. Why? So that you can properly chew food and digest and remain healthy. But Daddy, why? You need healthy teeth and for a nice smile. But Daddy, why? Well, okay, so that someday you'll have a nice smile, you'll meet somebody, and you'll move out. Sometimes the truth hurts. So why me, Lord? What have I ever done to deserve even one of the blessings? Did we even deserve them? No. It's called grace. In the first reading from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 10, we hear, "You were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you once lived." And it says, following the course of this world. Number 2, following the ruler of the power of the air. And I thought, what does Paul mean by that? The ruler of the power of the air sounds like Wonder Woman. But the ruler of the power of the air is a metaphor for Satan, or the bad choices that we make. Number 3, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh. Wow, when we look at what the scholars have to say about this, when we're saying that, and when we read that once lived among the passions of their flesh, we think of one thing. But flesh isn't necessarily the physical flesh, but it's the leading of a self-centered life. The passions of the flesh mean a self-centered life. When it's like a child, it's about me. Having grown up. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which He loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses and our self-centeredness, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. By God's grace. And God raised us up with Him and set up us with Him in the heavenly places, in and through Christ Jesus, in the heavenly places, not in the clouds, but in the heavenly places. The kingdom of God is more than something above the clouds. It's all around us. So that in the ages to come, He might show the immeasurable riches of His grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For we are what He has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. God has prepared our way of life before we were born. But it's our choice to say yes to that way of life. And it's for us all. It's for all the whosoever's. Miss March says so eloquently. Then we read in John chapter 3, verses 14 through 21, the gospel reading, that whosoever believes in Him may have eternal life. Wow, the scholars have a different view of that. I think for once I might agree with them. Eternal life does not speak of immortality or a future life in heaven, but it's a metaphor for living now in the unending presence of God. Eternal life doesn't speak of immortality or a future life in heaven, but it's a metaphor for living now in the unending presence of God. Jesus offered his own life through being lifted up, they say, on the cross, makes eternal life possible for all those who believe. This is the new life Jesus promised. In Nicodemus, in John chapter 3, 3 and 5, he says that. In the same chapter of John, Jesus tells Nicodemus earlier in this chapter, no one can see and experience the kingdom of God without being born from above. So when I'm born from above, I'm experiencing the kingdom of God, not in 20, 30, 40 years when my physical presence is gone. But now, so do you see this journey of the who, what, when, and why, now, and where is not independent. They're all interrelated. They're all reliant on one another. Wow. I don't know about you, but my suitcase is full. It's a lot to take in, isn't it? Wonderful. It's a blessing. This 40 days, it wasn't 3 days, it was 40 for a reason, because we have a lot to learn on these 40 days. For God so loved the world, for the whosoever. But the last verse of verse 21, but those who do what is true come to the light so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. We know we don't serve God to be noticed by others, but others should see God's works through us. They should experience just a glimpse, just a taste of what heaven itself may be like through us being made in God's image. Wow. It's a buffet, isn't it? This book is a buffet of wisdom about love, how to live. Chris Christopherson, you heard the song. Why me, Lord? What have I ever done to deserve even one of the pleasures I know? He says, what did I ever do that was worth loving you or the kindness you've shown? I watched a video. Chris Christopherson took off. He was a movie star and singer and all that. But last night I watched a video. In the video, he told his story about how he wrote that song and why. He said, I'm in Nashville, Tennessee. Good city. And I'm there for a recording, and I meet up with a good friend of mine. It wasn't Dottie West, but one of the people like that. And he said, we did our recording on Saturday, and she looked at me and she says, Chris, tomorrow I want you to go to church. Ooh, I don't really do church. Chris, come on, you can do it. I'll buy dinner and go to church. Okay. They get up the next morning, they go to church. He says, I come into church and it's in me, I felt uncomfortable. He said, I watched, but as they sang, as they prayed, as they read the word of God, he said, I felt something move. He said, but then it got rowdy and I watched people stand up and arms started waving back and forth and back and forth, and they did that like a lower order. But I opened my ears and I listened. I listened. And he said, I'm not putting my arm up because somebody will look at me. But before I could help it, my arm went up. mumbling something about accepting Jesus Christ in your life. And he says, he felt it for the first time. He said, then next what happened is he started walking down the aisle going to the front. He said, ain't no way. But what happened next is my feet started moving. He walked up front to the altar and he was with the other people. And he had his arm waving back and forth. And he said again, he heard the pastor saying something about accepting Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And he says, I couldn't really tell what he was saying, but I knew one thing, that I have been forgiven. He said, I have been forgiven. Through that experience, he went back to his hotel room and he wrote this song. That's where the words came from. What have I ever done to deserve even one of the blessings? I've seen them all around me. I've experienced the blessings. But at the end, he says, what can I give back to you? He says, but now that I know that I've needed you so, help me, Jesus. My soul's in your hands. Why, Jesus, my soul's in your hands. From this text today, it talks about eternal life. We've talked about eternal life. But when you become a believer in Jesus Christ, there is no death. Everlasting life begins not when your physical passes, but it begins when you accept Jesus into your heart and into your life. In Proverbs chapter 12, verse 28, it says, in the way of righteousness is life, and in his pathway there is no death. There is no death. Why? That's the question today. God extended grace to us. And since we were created in God's image, we must extend grace to all others whom we know. Just like God and by the example given us to us through Jesus. And that's why. Now on this Lenten journey, the focus is Jesus and justice. And I was reflecting last night on the social justice that happens in this church and in this community. Last week there was 28 people who served people who were hungry that came into the fellowship hall next door. Without condition, everyone was a whosoever. With everybody who's here today, who's ever served over there on Thursday during Ruth's ministry, who's ever helped support it financially, who's done all the things that make that happen, provide 8,000 meals a day in clothing and shelter and love and compassion, would everybody who's just been any part of that just raise your hand? Wow. That's social justice. Last week, there was an outside group of 25 people who heard about this ministry. I saw a picture somebody took of it. There was 25 extra people that came from an organization to help the 28 other people. So we have 53 people waiting on 150 people. That's one per three. That's a pretty good ratio. You don't get that at any. The second annual interfaith service we have going on the grounds again on March 25th, Palm Sunday at 3 o'clock. There'll be a stage even erected outside because we're expecting 300 to 400 people to come together. To come together in unity and discover what we have in common, that's social justice. For the March on Our Lives in Parkland that's coming up, the day before the gathering. gathering of spiritual leaders were organizing to march in unison in Parkland City itself to show the strength of the spiritual community in support of that community and around the world. Next Sunday is the Florida AIDS Walk. We have many people here today that are going to walk in that. If you're going to walk in that room, maybe even more than that just did. Look at the people who's going to walk for social justice. So why? Why? Because it's a way to experience God. There's an abundance of why all around us. So during this time of Lent, let's reflect on the connection between who, what, when, why, and where. Like I said, they're eventually related. And where begins right here. It's next week's topic, where. That's right here. And the question may just be, where are the injustices for which Jesus seeks justice? Maybe Jesus will flip some more tables. Not in this temple, but maybe in our thinking, in our belief, in our call to ministry. Amen. Funds for completion of the garden,
There will be many opportunities for donation of time and talent. If you're handy with a paintbrush, your talents can be employed to help paint the walls of the garden, which sorely need refurbishment. On the other hand, if you have a green thumb and or knowledge of local plants, we will welcome your help in actually making a living garden of the Garden of Memories. If I've mentioned anything that's caught your attention, drop by the office or see me at fellowship or any time to volunteer. Your time and talents will be treasured, believe me. Combining the time, talents, and treasures of many will help bring this project to completion, where we all may be able to celebrate the community of UCC Fort Lauderdale. Thank you.
God, we thank you for the gift of life itself. We thank you for the gift of love. We thank you for the blessings and the abundance you continue to surround us with. As we return just a portion of those blessings to you, we ask your blessing upon them so that they are used in your name, in your honor, and for your glory, Lord. And it's in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Dear United Church of Christ, Fort Lauderdale, this is a table of whosoever's. Whosoever. All people are welcome here in this place. All people are welcome at this table as Jesus fed 5,000, plus the men, women, and the children. We make no exception. And you're to be here. All are invited to experience Jesus.
Let us pray, but let us keep our eyes open and look around. God, we realize that we are a motley crew. But we are a bunch of whosoevers. Not only are we a bunch of whosoevers, but because of what you did for us, every one of us is forgiven. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. touched today by God's love and grace while viewing our worship service, and we hope to see you in person one day. We at the United Church of Christ, Fort Lauderdale, are an open and affirming church that believes in equality for all. We have many ministries that reach out to the needs of those in our community, and there's always something here for everyone to be involved in. We believe that God is still speaking and that our ministry outreach can only continue its vital mission in bringing people to Christ through the support of people just like you. Please visit our website, uccftl.org, for more information about us, to submit a prayer request, or even donate to the church if you have been moved by the Spirit. You will help us in God's work in our ministry outreach. We look forward to hearing from you soon, and we hope to see you next week. May God's peace and love be with each and every one of you. And remember, God is still speaking.